Welcome, everyone. My name is Rick, and I'll be the moderator for the debate tonight. The title, Does God Exist? I'm the pastor of a church started here in Eugene called the Gospel Community Church, and we wanted to facilitate a debate like this for three reasons. One, we believe it's important for Christians and non-Christians, or religious and non-religious, to hear both sides of an argument. Only learning and hearing one side of any topic doesn't do much to sharpen one's intellect. In a lot of ways, I believe it's better to know the opposite side of your belief system better than you know you're wrong, so you know what you're arguing against. Second, we believe a debate like this should not cause division inside of the community, but instead bring the community closer together through learning to value people who hold different beliefs than yourself. And third, we believe the question, does God exist, is the most important question you can ask and answer, because if he does, as I believe, we should know what he says and what he requires, and if he doesn't exist, as Bernie believes, we need to know how that changes our lives and perspectives. Before I introduce our debaters, I want to give a big thanks to the Barn by East for hosting this debate, being hospitable and showing their love and value for our community, and desire to see and value diversity. Thomas and Mark, thank you so much for allowing this, and a big congrats to Mark on the new baby boy, Wes. I believe it's important to help support a local business because as supporting our local businesses, it helps our overall economy here in Eugene. Therefore, since we have been blessed by them, we'd ask that you please, for your cover charge, buy a beverage of choice. They have kombucha, tea, coffee, beer, wine, spirits, all of the above, and leave a good tip. Please, I think this goes without being said, but no heckling or comments during the debate. Just please be respectful. We'd even ask that you hold off on any applauses for now, because it takes a little bit of time for that to quiet back down and for us to get started again. So just hold off on that. There's going to be a time at the end of the debate if you do have questions for a question and answer. With that, first, I want to introduce Bernie Dehler. First, I want to say thank you, Bernie, for Bernie has a wife and kids, and he's taking time away from them to drive down here from Portland to debate. So first of all, thank you for taking the time to do that. Bernie was raised as a Roman Catholic and became a born-again Christian in 1984. After 25 years as a growing evangelical Christian, Bernie became an atheist in 2007. Since then, he has debated numerous Christian pastors, professors, and ministry leaders from all denominations. He is also the author of the booklet Modern Science and Philosophy Destroyed Theology. Okay. He has those copies available. Our second debater tonight is Ronny Gogan. Ronny formally, which is a pretty interesting dynamic, is we have someone who was a Christian and is now an atheist, and someone who was an atheist and is now a Christian. So Ronny, formerly an atheist, converted to Christianity 4 years ago. His conversion has led to a deep love for apologetics and debating the truths he now believes. Ronny recently moved to Springfield, Oregon from Reno, Nevada. He serves in the military and is a member of Gospel Community Church. The outline for our debate will be a 5-minute opening statement from Bernie Dehler, followed by a 5-minute opening statement from Ronny Gogan. After this, each party will have 10 minutes of cross-examination. I'll ask each of you guys right now during cross-examination to be clear and loud with your questions. And if you're up for examining Ronny, we would ask that you ask the questions. And so you guys know, they're not being rooted if they try to redirect the questions to each other. They just want to be real clear in getting the answers that they're looking for. So you guys have full command and authority to rephrase that or reel that back in. So after the cross-examination, there will be a 30-minute dialogue, and then there will be a 5-minute closing statement from both Bernie and Ronnie. The last 20 minutes tonight will be for question and answer, so please prepare your questions during the debate. We ask for questions, not statement and answer, so please formulate your question within 30 seconds. Don't give an opinion or a statement for a minute and a half, and then find a question at the end of that, just for the sake of time. So. I will run the clock, and I'll let each of our debaters know when they are approaching their time limit. So, with that, I want to welcome. Oh, yeah. Bernie mentioned that it'd be kind of cool to just ask the audience tonight, if you guys don't mind raising your hands. I know some people hate that, but how many of you guys in here would call yourself Christians?
Don't even bother asking.
What about agnostic or atheist or non-religious? Awesome. Cool.
Yeah.
He's bringing it in.
We have a seat up here in the front, by the way.
Yeah.
And there's one over here, too. There's room still.
This is my district.
This is right. Hey, guys. We plan on this debate being casual, but like I said, just trying to keep the chatter and everything down so that you guys can hear them well. They're not mic, but is our sound okay at the back right now? You guys can hear us good? Well, I've asked them to use their big boy voices, so. All right, Bernie, you are up.
Okay, I had some notes here. I'm sorry I didn't have enough. Check it out. Here's an extra copy you guys can have asked. Okay, does God exist? I would say the Bible God does not exist, and I didn't share tonight how you can falsify that. Some people say you can't prove or disprove God, and I disagree. I think the Bible God, you can't falsify. So here's how you can do it. Step one, you define what this God is. What did he do? If he did something, did it leave a mark on the world? And if he did leave a mark on the world, can we test it? And if we test it and find out that it didn't happen, then you need to stop believing in that God or go back to step one and redefine your God and say, okay, that God doesn't exist. Now my God actually did this. So there's actually two big events in the Bible which we can scientifically test. And that has to do with the origins of the universe and the origins of humans. And so what we do is this. These two things are so important and interesting that it actually divides creationists into different camps. You have younger creationists, older creationists, and what we call evolutionary creationists. So we're going to start with the most literal interpretation. And I'm going to introduce a term. It's called ratcheting concordism. This is from an evangelical Christian who's also a biological scientist. He came up with this. His name is Dennis Meenema. He has some YouTube videos talking about the evolution, the DNA evidence for evolution. And what he means by this is concordism means people who say science corresponds to the Bible, and this is how you mix the two together. And by ratcheting concordism, what he means is that as you find something that's falsified in the Bible, then they just say, okay, we'll take that figure, and you know, it still works. And so if there's all these conflicts and you have to continually say, okay, well that's figurative, okay, that's figurative, okay, that's figurative, sooner or later, there's nothing in the Bible to teach you about science whatsoever, and that's the final state that evangelical or the evolutionary creationist is in that says the Bible doesn't teach you anything about science, it's about theology. So if you start with young earth creationism, as made famous by Ken Ham at the Creation Museum and people like Kent and Eric Hoven, they say the universe is only 6,000 years old, and that's when God made everything about 6,000 years ago over a period of 6 days. With modern cosmology, we know the universe is about 13.8 billion years old. That's a factor of a million times off times two. So that's quite a bit off. So that God does not exist. So then the creationists will say, okay, that's true. That God did not do that. Okay, our God, you go to the older creationists where they accept all of cosmology, but now they still have a problem with evolution. They say God made humans at one point. They did not descend from other animals. Okay, well, I'd like to introduce the idea that I think this is magical thinking. They're basically saying there was a time in history where there was no humans, and the next day, boom, there's humans. There was no whales, boom, God made whales. There was no birds, boom, God made birds. That's how they think God made everything. With evolution, we know there's no such thing as a first human, and evolution is a fact that it happened. How it happened is a theory. So we know that this God does not exist. There is no God that made humans, boom, from scratch. This is modern biology. So then the Christian will say, okay, well, this we'll take that figuratively. So we believe God created everything through evolution. So the problem with that, I think the next step is with neurology. And I think that neurology falsifies the idea of a supernatural soul. I think we just have the brain that emerges, or the mind that emerges from the brain. And I give 4 or 5 points about this. I'm not going to have time to go over this in my introductory statement. It's only 5 minutes. If you have the notes, you can ask me about this in the Q&A time. So here's the killer idea, though. If there is no supernatural soul, then the whole gospel doesn't make sense. There's no longer a hope of resurrection. There's nothing to resurrect. There's no soul. Minute left. Okay. And then additional to all this, there's philosophical problems, like the New Testament has obvious myths, such as, you know, if a snake bites you, you're not going to get hurt. Well, there's creatures that dance with snakes, bite, get bitten, and die. The problem of evil is another huge problem, which I'm not going to have time to go into, but we can talk to in the Q&A. And at the very heart of the gospel, it's nonsense. Basically, it says God killed himself to appease his own wrath. I mean, when you think about about this whole idea of sacrifice and all this, it just doesn't seem to make any sense. God is supposed to be immortal, and here he died on a cross and came back to life again. And Jesus and God are the same thing, but yet God sacrificed his own son, and they're the same God, and you know, this whole, it's just nonsense upon nonsense, it seems. So anyway, I just talked about the science and philosophy, so just a quick introduction.
Time right there, actually. Ronny, you're up.
Thank you all for coming tonight, and thank you again to the owners of the Barn Light for allowing us to use this venue. Please be generous to their staff, and I hope you enjoy the debate. Now, I'd like to start this debate by recognizing that there is no king but Christ. My hope is that he would be glorified through this debate. Now, the question of this debate is, does God exist? Now, as a Christian, when I say God, I specifically refer to the triune God of Scripture. And I intend to demonstrate that he does in fact exist by the impossibility of the contrary. That is, that without the Christian God of the Bible, you couldn't even formulate that question in any sort of meaningful way. Now, before I lay out my arguments, I want to clarify this issue before it is brought up. What I will not argue at any point tonight is that those outside of the Christian faith do not do good things, or that they don't know truth, use logic, test hypotheses, or reason rational conclusions. I've actually met plenty of them that can do some of these things quite well. Sometimes better than I or any Christian I've ever met can. What I'm instead saying is that without the Christian God of the Bible, you lack the essential conditions that must be fulfilled in order to comprehend such things as logic, science, and morality. First, logic. When my esteemed opponent accuses me of being illogical in my argumentation or beliefs, he assumes an absolute standard of logic or rationale that I have deviated from. For if there is no absolute standard of rationality with which one may deviate from, then all my opponent can say about my reasoning is that it's just different. Not that it's any better or worse, just different. For when he says he's being more rational than I, that would immediately assume a transcendent rationale, and at that point he would be borrowing from my worldview. Second, science. Science only survives based on the principle of induction. Basically, the principle of induction says that the sun will rise tomorrow because it always has in the past. So it's reasoning based off of our past experiences. This type of reasoning is circular and fallacious without the Christian God. For if I was to ask you, how do you know that the future will be like the past? You're stuck saying, well, because the future's always been like the past. So the principle of induction cannot on its own lead to the proof of the principle of induction, because that circle is broken by fallible human memory. Neither can the scientific method lead to the proof of the scientific method. I once had a professor in college tell me and all the students in my class that science was the best way to know truth. When I pressed her on this and I asked her, well, how did you use science in order to determine that science was the best way to know truth? She was stumped, had no answer for the question, and ended up asking the class. And no one had an answer, because the only answer is that it can't. Finally, morality. It was somewhat brought up in Bernie's opening statement. But when you bring a moral indictment against the God of the Bible, you presuppose his existence. You assume some absolute morality that God has deviated from when you say he is being immoral. At that point again, you've borrowed from the Christian worldview and have failed to stand on the foundations of your own professed beliefs about the world. In this debate, I would humbly ask the audience to pay very special attention to what the debaters are saying and ask yourself this simple question. Are the things they say consistent with what they profess to believe about the world? Well, I submit to you that this debate itself presupposes the existence of God, because we're both standing on the moral principle that it is wrong to lie or harm one another in order to win this debate, and that the question, does God exist, can be either true or false. You see, God says, you shall not deal falsely, you shall not lie to one another, Leviticus 19:11. This is the nature of God. So as beings made to reflect his goodness, Christians have an absolute standard as to why we should not deal in falsehoods. Atheism cannot tell us why we ought not lie, especially if lying leads to more pragmatic results. At that point, why not do it? Also, atheism cannot tell us what truth is and how we can come to know it. To say a question could be either true or false assumes Christianity is true, because it's the only worldview that can tell us what truth is and how we can access it. And inaccessible knowledge is just as useless as no knowledge at all. No other worldview can give us access to knowledge or define exactly what it is within its own framework.
30 seconds.
Instead, when arguments are cast against the only God that does exist, concepts and truths from Christianity are borrowed in order to make an assault against it, as will be demonstrated through the cross-examination and open dialogue this evening. Thank you.
Now we're going to move into a cross-examination. Bernie, we'll let you start. You have 10 minutes of cross-examination. During this time, you can lead with any of the questions that Ronny has just brought up, or you can lead with your own questions. You have 10 minutes, and the floor is yours. So, okay. Please make your questions clear, and Ronny, please make your answers clear.
Okay, I'd like to start with, I don't believe there's any evidence, good evidence, for the existence of God. So can you name me one evidence to deal with here? What's the best evidence for the existence of God?
The best evidence for the existence of God, I would say the ultimate proof of creation, or the best evidence for God, would be His revealed word to us. So the Bible would be one, but also a general sense of revelation. So there's special revelation and there's general revelation.
Let's just focus on one thing. So give me one piece of evidence for God's existence.
So God has revealed himself to us through his word, through his son Jesus Christ, and...
So you're saying the Bible is evidence for God's existence?
Yes.
And what is it about the Bible that proves the existence of God?
What is it about the Bible that proves the existence of God?
Yeah, because I mean, I know the Bible pretty well, and I don't think it's evidence for the existence of God. So why do you say that's evidence for the existence of God?
I think it's evidence for the existence of God because, basically, I don't know if I like the term evidence so much. I guess, let me say this. The ultimate evidence for me that there is a God is that you're asking that question to me. So that, because you're asking for evidence, you're assuming that we can know truth, you assume that we can know things about our universe, that it's uniform and we can discover things. So I would say, just you asking those kinds of questions would be evidence for me that there is a God. Specifically, the God of the Bible.
Yeah, I think that sounds like it's kind of like circular reasoning when they say begging the question. For example, if you say, like, why is the Bible God's word? Yes. Why? Because God said so in his word. It's kind of like self-referential, or it could be a bald assertion where you're saying something without any evidence. So just asserting that you can't know anything unless God existed. I mean, we wouldn't be here unless God existed. That's just an assertion. That's not evidence.
I know I can't ask questions, but was that a question?
Yeah, I'm still looking. It doesn't seem like evidence to me.
Well, you say that I was using circular reasoning.
Yeah, I'm still looking for evidence for God's existence. I mean, like, for example, do you believe that God made the world 6,000 years ago?
Yes.
Okay, so right there, it seems like we have an end of discussion because, I mean, honestly, it seems like you're not up to speed on modern science. If people have a different knowledge base, we can't have a reasonable discussion. So I would tell an apologist, a Christian apologist, a person who preaches defends the faith, you're not even in the game until you understand modern science. And because you don't accept evolution, you don't accept modern cosmology and modern biology, how can we even have that discussion?
Well, you presuppose that that's all true.
It's an academic question, and like we talked earlier, I mentioned that every state university, in some states like Oregon have three of them, Oregon State, University of Oregon, Portland State, every single one teaches evolution as a fact that humans evolved from other animals in their curriculum. Not one teaches creation science or anything about God did things like boom, magic, poof kind of stuff. This is just the level of, this is an academic thing. I mean, there's no question over it. It's not like they're debating. It's not a scientific debate. In science, it's a well-known fact that humans evolved from other animals.
Can you formulate the question for Ronny?
I guess let me just say my frustration and see what you have to say about it. How are we supposed to have an intellectual discussion when,
I don't
in my viewpoint, somebody is not up to speed The knowledge base is not up to speed with modern knowledge.
So I would say that that's a presupposition and still argument that's going on. I think you haven't clearly stated a case for evolution for all of us to sit here and say absolutely 100% agree with that, with your presuppositions about evolution. So to sit here and say that it's a, you know, a proven fact, I don't even think it is a proven fact, so I don't buy into that assumption outright from the very beginning. I don't think it is a proven fact.
Okay, so I mean, it seems like, is it that they can go over evolution? I mean, I could bring up facts for evolution. How many people in here, can I ask a quick question?
Yeah.
How many people do not believe that humans evolved from other animals? Okay, so most of you believe, okay. All right. Okay, so have you studied the evidence for evolution?
Yes.
Do you know what pseudogenes are?
Yes, I have heard of pseudogenes.
Okay, so why are pseudogenes not overwhelming evidence? And just by themselves, there's so much more in DNA, but just pseudogenes alone, why is that not overwhelming evidence for evolution?
Excellent.
I think it'd be helpful just real quick for the audience to give like a, you know, a 10-second or 20-second highlight of what pseudogenes are.
So for example, with evolution, for example, our olfactory sense, our sense of smell, and we can smell different odors, okay? We have thousands of broken genes that don't work anymore for that function. And the reason why we know is because they know what a gene is, because they have certain start and stop codes. And other animals have these genes that work in rats and dogs and things like that. We can see we have the same exact gene, but they're chopped up or they're missing bits or something like that. They no longer work. So we can see busted genes. Now, the creationists will say sometimes, like, well, there's still function for those genes, but still it's obvious. They've co-opted for some other use in some cases. But the point is, we know what those genes were in our ancestry. They were actually working, and now there's thousands of these, just in the olfactory sense alone, from what I understand.
Can I respond to that?
Yeah.
So I would say the biggest problem here is that any evidence that we bring to the table, you and I are going to look at it through completely different lenses. You're going to look at it through the atheistic perspective, and you're going to see all these pseudogenes and say, look, here we have evidence of common ancestry between the species. While I'm going to look at the evidence through my Christian lens, and I'm going to say, look, we have a common creator who created us all, and there's a similar gene code throughout all of his creation. So the evidence is kind of pointless, because you and I are both going to interpret it different ways.
But it has nothing to do with being a Christian. I think it has to do with looking at the evidence, because there are Christians like Francis Collins. There's evangelical Christians. There's a YouTube video with Dennis Bienema, who's an evangelical Christian. He's a biological scientist. He gives a tutorial on the evidence as seen in the DNA, and he's an evangelical Christian.
About 3 minutes left.
So, I mean, it has nothing to do with being a Christian, so you can't say it's a Christian atheist thing.
Well, he may have some presuppositions that put him in a corner to where he feels he needs to bend to whatever modern science is saying.
His testimony is that he actually wanted to disprove evolution when he was studying for his PhD. He was a creationist up to even getting a PhD, and when he ran across his paper as a PhD, he says, okay, that's it, I accept evolution, but he said he didn't have to worry about becoming an atheist because he knew going into that, there was other theistic evolutionists, so he knew there was a path for him as an evolutionist to still believe.
I'm going to reel you guys back home, because you only have about 2.5 minutes left to ask whatever questions at this time that you have for Ronny, and for Ronny to get answered.
Okay. I don't think it's true that it's a Christian versus atheist thing. I think it's a matter of knowledge, and I was a Christian, I accepted evolution, then finally I had to leave the faith, but I don't think a Christian sees things differently. I accepted evolution as a Christian and remained a Christian because I knew other Christians that were evolutionists, so it's not about being a Christian.
But the evidence itself doesn't speak, it doesn't say anything, it doesn't say evolution is true, it's just evidence, and then we have to interpret what exactly the evidence is, and we do that according to our presuppositions that we hold already.
No, it's not about presuppositions. It's like seeing footprints. If you see footprints, you know somebody walked from here to there. If they said they flew, you can say, you did not fly, I can see your footprints.
But the footprints didn't say, hey, somebody walked this way. You had your presuppositions from your past experience in the world to know that when I see footprints, that somebody has walked here. So you have a presupposition. Somebody who's never seen footprints in the sand before may have a completely different theory than what you have. So our presuppositions will affect how we interpret the evidence that we come into contact with.
Okay, I think in my example, I think there are footprints, and the claim is that basically, oh, somebody flew from here or there. How'd they do it? There was magic. It just happened. But when you see the footprints, and you can see the footprints matching the shoe and all that stuff, You can say you weren't there to see it happen. It doesn't matter. Just like DNA at a crime scene. Nobody saw it happen, but they know this person's the killer because they have the DNA under their fingerprint and all this. You put, it's called abductive logic, when you put everything to get to the best explanation.
But a cop's going to have a different explanation of that kind of evidence than you would, somebody who's just a civilian out in the streets.
But it can be a Christian problem, because there's Christians who accept evolution.
Well, they have a presupposition already that they have to conform to whatever the modern science of the day is saying, because they'll be mocked and laughed at if they don't.
No, I was a Christian that rejected evolution, and I was a Christian that accepted evolution when I learned the other.
Well, I also don't believe in your presupposition that you were. So that's another thing I don't buy into.
You think I'm lying or what?
No, it's not that I don't think you're lying.
10 seconds.
It's that I don't believe that you were ever at any point in your life a Christian.
You say you're a Christian now. I can say I don't believe you're a Christian. So what? It doesn't mean anything.
Well, because the Bible has something specifically to say.
This time we're going to turn it over to Ronny to ask your questions to Bernie. So Ronny, you're up. You have 10 minutes.
Bernie. Could you be wrong about everything you know?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. How do you know that?
How do I know that? Well, you know, the funniest thing is, if I could be wrong about everything I know, if I say yes, what if I was wrong about that?
It does. So,
what if I'm wrong about being wrong about everything I know?
That puts you in a position where you're refuting yourself. So, do you think that you could be wrong about that?
Can I tell you why I could be wrong about everything?
Tell me.
I mean, potentially, I could be dreaming right now. You know when you're in a dream, everything seems real? How do I know that I'm not dreaming right now?
Right. Okay, hold on. So you could be wrong about everything you know.
Sure. And you too, right?
No, I can't be wrong about everything.
In my view, you can.
In my view, I don't think you could be wrong about everything you know. So let me ask the next question.
In my view, we can both be wrong about everything we know.
Right. In your view, yes. But you could be wrong about that.
I think I could be wrong and you, right?
Yes. You could be wrong about being... You could be wrong that you think that I could be wrong about everything. So, anyways, so because you could be wrong about everything, when you say, because earlier you said evolution is a fact. That was a direct quote from you. Evolution is a fact.
Right.
But you could be wrong about that.
Sure.
Okay. So you're not giving us truth claims or anything like that. You're just giving us your opinions or your beliefs?
Of course, yes.
Okay. How tall do you think I am?
5, 10, 11.
Could you be wrong about that?
Yeah.
Okay. You could be wrong about it because you don't know it.
Sure.
Okay. Just to clarify then.
But you know what? There's different ranges. I mean, for sure, you're over 3 feet. If somebody says Ronny is under 3 feet, I said, no, I don't think
But you can't be certain to any degree.
For certain? Then you're not certain, of course. I'm not going to say I'm certain about anything. No, I mean, I could have always had a hollow lens here that's invisible in front of me and distorts everything I've seen.
So you don't believe in absolute certainty? Absolute certainty doesn't exist for you.
No, I would never say I'm absolutely certain about anything.
Are you absolutely certain about that?
Am I absolutely certain about that?
Okay, let me move this along. So, just to clarify then, you admit now that you could be wrong about everything now?
Sure.
Okay. So, I gave that example of my height just to demonstrate that you could be wrong about everything you know, because you know nothing.
Oh, what?
Well, listen, the things you could be wrong about, you could be wrong about them because you don't know them.
What?
If you could be wrong about everything, then that's one of the things that you don't know, is everything.
Right, I mean, I could be dreaming, I could be in the Matrix, I could be a...
All right, so now, in a debate about truth, you admitted within the first couple seconds of my cross-examination that your worldview does not have access to absolute truth.
It's not... I don't believe any of us know everything, so I'm not sure.
Well, I'm not saying you need to know everything, but you can know some things.
Not 100% certain. Like I said, we could be dreaming.
Let's continue. Do you believe the best way to validate a truth claim is through empirical observation?
That and logic, also deductive logic is another way.
Deductive logic?
Mm-hmm.
Well, explain deductive logic real quick. How do you define that?
There's a form of logic called deduction, where it's called a syllogism, where you usually have a if A then B, A therefore B, and so basically you
get. Okay. So you're talking about the infinite regress.
No, I'm talking about deductive logic is a form of logic that's called deductive logic.
So you believe in the laws of logic?
Sure.
Okay, are you a naturalistic atheist?
Yeah.
So you, would I, is this a fair assessment if I say that all you believe in is matter and motion?
All I believe is matter and motion.
Or that's matter and energy, or matter?
Well, matter is kind of, at the Big Bang there was no matter, it's just energy.
Okay, so as a naturalistic atheist, what is that? What is a naturalistic atheist?
It means nature is all there is, there's nothing supernatural, there's no magic.
Okay. So
the natural world exists. There's no ghosts and goblins and all that.
Okay. So there's nothing, so everything in this world is material in nature?
Not material, but natural. I mean, there's energy, it's not material.
But it's measurable. Everything in this universe is measurable.
I'm not sure what you mean by measurable, because at the Big Bang there was just pure energy. There was no, not even a proton or a neutron. So I'm not sure what you mean by measurable.
Because what I'm trying to get at is, what do you think the product of our minds is?
Our mind emerges from our brain. From brain activity, that's our mind.
Brain activity. And so what's happening in our minds right now is we're all sitting here listening to this debate. We have a chemical process going on in our
brains.
So on a very, very nanoscopic level, the atoms in our brain are bending to the laws of physics, and they're, you know, synapses are firing in our brain, and we're thinking, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if I took an ounce of potassium and I threw it in a little jar of water, there'd be a little chemical reaction that would happen, right?
Maybe, I don't know about chemistry.
Okay, there'd be a little bit of an explosion. Now, if I did the exact same thing with sodium in a different beaker, I toss in, there'd be another chemical reaction. So there's two different chemical reactions happening. There's a potassium in the water and a sodium in the water.
Mm-hmm.
Which one of those is true?
Neither one. I mean, true doesn't apply to...
Okay, so we're not...
That's like saying, is green true or blue true or is...
Okay, so we're not getting a truth right now. You are just having a chemical reaction in your brain right now that's atheistic in nature, and I'm having a chemical reaction in my brain that's Christian in nature. We're not actually discussing any kind of truth. We're not getting towards the truth at all.
So I think your misunderstanding there is you think a chemical reaction with sodium or whatever you said is akin to the brain, but the neurons are totally different. The way brain traces work, the way the brain works, it has nothing to do with throwing chemicals in the water.
But it's just on the nanoscopic level. I mean, you're adding something to it that doesn't exist. You're saying that...
No, I mean, you need a neuron structure. You need a brain structure in order to think. Pop and...
But how do you know you're thinking right now? You could just be having a chemical reaction in your brain atheistically right now.
They are chemical reactions.
But it's just, it's a strict determinism, is it not? That the only reason you're an atheist is because of the chemical reactions that happen throughout your brain. And the atoms are just bending to the laws of physics. They don't have a choice.
Well, there is, I think, a feedback loop, I think, which is very important. There's a feedback loop. So, I have an engineering degree, and we learned about op-amps, where you get some of the output and it goes back in, feeds into the input. So, our brains, we use input to think. Our brains have output, and then we have input to consider and evaluate and get more output based on that.
Okay.
There's a feedback cycle.
Okay, is that a fact or is that just your opinion?
It's my opinion. Everything's my opinion.
Is that your opinion?
Yeah.
Okay, so that may, even the fact that everything is your opinion, that itself is an opinion as well. That's not a truth claim either.
Everything I have is my opinion.
Okay, so you're just giving us your opinion.
Yes.
I have some questions.
You're giving your opinion, right?
Real quick, I'm going to go through.
2.5 minutes.
So, do you think it's wrong to murder?
Depends. Not wrong.
Murder, not kill. Murder.
No, like if I could go back in time and murder Hitler, I would. So it's not wrong in that case.
Okay.
So it depends on the situation.
Do you think it's wrong to lie and steal?
Again, it depends on the situation. It's good to lie to Hitler. If you're hiding Jews, it's a good thing to lie.
Is it good to lie in a debate about truth?
What?
Is it good to lie in a debate about truth?
I don't know, I'd have to think about it.
Okay.
You ask me off the top of my head.
Do you think we should pursue truth? Do you think truth is a good thing to pursue? Why?
I believe that ultimately your life is better when you seek the truth because it's
going to... Well, I have to stop you there. What do you mean by better?
It's going to result in less pain in your life because...
Why does that matter from an atheistic perspective?
Because nobody likes pain and everybody likes pleasure.
Well, just because you arbitrarily choose between pain and pleasure, it doesn't...
not really arbitrary. I mean, it really is. People love to be loved. People like to give love, like to receive love.
Not everybody.
Most normal people.
So you determine truth on consensus. So if the most people agree on it, then that is a truth for you. Or something that should be pursued, at least.
Well, when you're talking about, see, I should probably explain what my definition of morality is.
Maybe in the open dialogue.
What's that?
Maybe in the open dialogue.
You have a minute left.
Yeah.
So what was the last question?
Well, I have a couple more. Do you think that we should establish the quality or reliability of something before we accept it as true?
Sure.
And then hold on to as many of those as possible?
Sure.
Okay. And you said you think we should pursue truth?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you think it's wrong to, do you think we should advance as a science, or as a society, create new technology and advance in that way? Do you think we should advance as a society, create new technology, you know, cure cancer, all this stuff, continuing to increase our knowledge of the universe? Would you like to live eternally in a perfected state and never die?
Sure. Yeah.
Why not? Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Do you think we should care for less fortunate?
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Do human beings have value and worth?
Yeah.
Why?
10 seconds.
Because of our sentience,
the brain says it's happening in our minds?
The interesting question is if there was more superior race that came, should we care for
that? You can close up. Go ahead.
Oh, and let's say, because it's my tribe, it's humans, it's easy for me to feel an affinity. A more interesting question might be what if there's more advanced aliens or advanced robots with greater knowledge than us? Do we want to maintain humanity when there's something better, whatever? I mean, you know, like us versus Neanderthals, if Neanderthals were still around.
Or if they ever existed.
All right. I don't know that much about that.
We're going to move into our open dialogue. Because we got started a little late, instead of doing 30 minutes of open dialogue, it's going to be 20 minutes. And so right now, Bernie and Ronnie are going to get to go back and forth and have an open dialogue. I'd ask you guys now to start writing down your questions, because whenever we get done with this, we're going to move into question and answer. So Bernie or Ronnie, would either one of you guys like to start the dialogue?
Sure.
Do you have a question you'd like to ask?
So you have a problem with me looking to the Bible as my ultimate authority for truth because you said it was circular.
Well, I have a master's in ministry degree. I know a little bit about the Bible. I've preached the Bible, and I don't think it's evidence for God. So I was asking you what your evidence for God is. Can I explain that a little bit more?
Yeah.
Okay, so if I said basically, let's say for example, I pull out a package of M&Ms, and I say, everybody see these pills here? These are cancer pills. This will cure your cancer. $10,000 each. Who wants to buy one? Okay? So, of course you're not going to do that. Nobody's going to give me $10,000 for a pill. You're going to say it has M&M on it. It's like a candy. So, I have the burden of proof. On a test like this, I have to do a double blind test, and show that it's better than placebo statistically. Okay? So, there's a burden of proof. So, If I said like, oh well, prove me wrong, it's obviously gonna, you know, it's obviously pure cancer unless you can prove me wrong, that's not right. You gotta say, look, if you're gonna make a claim, you gotta prove it. So this is a huge claim that God exists, supernatural beings exist. When I was a Christian, when I stopped believing in God, it's kind of interesting because I used to be kind of scared of the dark at night, you know? And so then it's like, you know what, I don't believe in God anymore, I don't believe in the devil either, so I can turn the nightlight off. Come on, devil, let's come on out. You know, what's going on? So it's kind of interesting facing those fears. And it's like, I'm looking for evidence for God. Where's the evidence?
But the fact that you're asking for evidence, evidence is your belief or your repressed knowledge of him. You know the Bible fairly well. So you know Romans 1, 18-23?
Well, refresh my memory. Is that the wrath of God being poured out?
Yes. So basically, just to sum it up for everybody, it says that we all know God, but some suppress that knowledge in unrighteousness. So it's part of their sin that they suppress that knowledge of God. It says if you were to hold a basketball underneath the water, you're holding it down, you're suppressing that truth. That's why when I said earlier that I don't think you were a Christian, because it doesn't make any sense. Christ was Lord over your reasoning. How do you reason out of that position?
I mean, you say that you believe in the Bible the way you do. It's no different than a Mormon saying, oh, look, the Book of Mormon says this. Or
except for
a Muslim saying the Quran says this. I mean, it means the same thing.
Well, one thing, there is one problem with that. Right now we're debating Christianity and atheism, but the problem is that the Book of Mormon and the Quran depend upon the authority of the Bible, even in their own literature.
In your view?
Well, and if you read the literature, it does.
They think the Book of Mormon is the most perfect book there is.
Well, that's because
your book is corrupted, and they feel so sincerely about they can cry about their testimony and Jesus touched them in the heart.
That's why we create very sophisticated worldviews to suppress that knowledge of God we all have.
You know what? When I was a Christian, I did not want to leave the faith. I basically said if I could find one thread to hold on to, I will remain a Christian. And I couldn't, at the end, I couldn't find one thread. So for me, I feel like I was led by God. I felt like I felt the presence of God. I felt like I prayed to God for direction. I felt the love of God. Whenever a Christian says I know God exists because I can feel it in my heart, I've been there. I know that.
Well, no, I'm not making an argument, but
I'm not suppressing anything.
Well, I would disagree. But because the Bible is my ultimate authority, so you're asking me right now to trust you over the authority of the Bible, even though you're just expressing your opinions right now. So let me ask you this question too. In my worldview,
you're expressing your opinions as well.
So. I don't believe that, but I know, I understand that you do. So let me ask you a question. In my worldview, I believe in an all-knowing, all-powerful God. Now, could He reveal things to me such that I can know them to be true? Some things to be true?
If He existed, I guess.
Okay, so in my worldview, you've given me an avenue for certainty that you lack.
Well, I mean, if you said, hey, I believe in a magical God, if that magical God existed and could do magic, is that possible? It's like, of course, if you have a magical God,
well, let me
exists. Once you believe in magic, anything's possible.
Well, let me ask you, you're trying to make it seem like it's less rational to believe in the Christian God, or any God at all, for that matter, or unicorns, or whatever. You think it's less rational to do that?
Because they get evidence.
Okay, what ultimate authority or ultimate standard of rationality are you appealing to when you say that my belief system is less rational than yours?
I don't understand the question.
All right, so you say my belief in...
I mean, we both agree in logic. We both agree the value of logic.
Although your worldview cannot account for it.
Do we both agree about logic? If we both agree that logic is valuable, we can move forward.
Well, I have a reason to not believe in contradictions, or to stay away from contradictions, but I don't think your worldview has a foundation to say we should avoid contradictions.
Do you think because I can't explain where logic came from that that's evidence for the existence of God?
Not that you can't explain where it came from, but that you can't account for it.
I can't account for something, so that's evidence for the existence of God?
No, the fact that you use it anyways, even though you cannot account for it, you evidence...
Why do I use logic?
Because you're creating God's image. God is logical.
That's not why I use it.
It is.
Why do you think I use it, personally? Why do you think my reason is? Why I use logic?
You probably think for some pragmatic reason, I'm guessing.
It works.
Exactly.
That's why.
Pragmatism. But pragmatism...
If it didn't work, I wouldn't use it.
But pragmatism is different than truth.
No.
You don't think pragmatism is different than truth?
Pragmatism? It's evidence.
No.
The only reason why I believe in science is because it works. If science did not work, I would not believe it.
But just so, okay, well, when you, there's two problems with that. One, when you say something works, you assume that had a purpose to begin with.
No, I'm saying you can make predictions and it comes true. It explains the world.
No, but when I say something works...
For example, like a fortune... Let's say we're going to go to a battle with another nation and somebody says... Okay, the best thing to do is to hurl curses. I have a special magical powers. We're going to hurl curses at the enemy. People have probably done that in the past, and they got wiped out and killed. Somebody else says, we're going to make ballistics. We're going to make missiles. Those guys won, and everybody's smart. You use what works. And that's why I use logic and science.
Yeah.
It works.
Okay.
People have tried supernatural things. They try it. It just fails. There's people who try to pray instead of go to the doctors, and they die. And it's so sad when their children die because that's the parents' belief.
But you're assuming that humans have value, dignity, and worth, and that it's better that humans flourish rather than perish. Okay, where do you get that in atheism?
I just told you that everybody wants, it's good to feel good. Everybody wants to feel good.
So
let's make everybody feel good as possible. Nobody wants to say, let's live in a world where everybody's at war with each other, everybody's fighting. If you had two choices, would you want to move to a community where everybody's fighting or move to a community where everybody's helping each other?
Well,
obviously, you want to go to the one because it feels good.
Yes, and I agree with you, but I think
that has nothing to do with God. It has to do with feeling.
I think it absolutely does, because the reason why we pursue that, you have these two arbitrary values. You have human flourishing and human suffering, but because we're all created in God's image, we want human flourishing because that's what God wants. Or else, if there was no God and we're just in a random chance universe, some people Well, I mean, some people do choose destruction over, they choose human suffering over human flourishing. But the reason why most of us choose human flourishing is most of us do believe in God and we do want human society to flourish. That is a good thing.
If they had two communities, they said, let's open up tomorrow. Nobody believes in God. Here's two communities. All these people over here, everybody who likes to fight and everybody go to this one, and everybody who likes to get along and love each other go to this one. The one that everybody loves each other and helps each other, that community is going to flourish. They're going to get more powerful and stronger. The other one's going to be infighting, killing each other, raping, killing, all this stuff. They're going to, if they don't self-disintegrate, they'll at least be overpowered by the bigger one. They're going to get better science, technology, medicine, and everything. It has nothing to do with God. It has to do with just feeling good.
So what you just said right there, so what? Who cares?
Who cares? Whoever's living in it.
So
you would care if you were in a mean society or a happy society.
Because I'm created in the image of God, and I want to flourish like God wants me to flourish.
No, because it feels good. You want to go to a place where people say, hi, how's it going? I love you. You don't want to go to a place where it's like, hey, there he is. Try to jump him, kill him, watch your back.
But when you say that this society, it would be better for this society over here to flourish, and it would be worse if you have this other society over here that's going to perish and go to war with one another, you're assuming, you're standing on my worldview because you're assuming that one is better than the other. And I know that you, right now you're evidencing your knowledge of God, your suppressed belief in God, because you're going for the human flourishing rather than the, and you're saying like, this is absolutely better, even though I'm sitting here saying this is just my opinion, but you're appealing to the human flourishing one rather than the human suffering one. But there's really, what's the difference? You're assuming purpose, but atheism does not cannot account for that kind of purpose.
See, the thing is, it has nothing to do with God, it has to do with consequences. It's all about consequences.
Who cares about the consequences?
Who cares? Everybody, if you want good consequences, you've got to operate a certain way. If you want bad consequences, you operate another way. It's all about consequences. It's a huge part of it.
But in atheism, what if somebody's not worried about the consequences all the time? You see people take their own life. There's no ultimate judgment after you die.
That's right. So what, there's no ultimate judgment when you're a Christian either. You can go around killing everybody you want, and on your deathbed, you come to Jesus, and yeah, where's the punishment? I mean, that's a travesty of justice itself.
Well, that's...
The whole gospel is all messed up on when it comes to that.
I don't know if I agree with that theology you just laid out, but you probably have to string that out a little bit more, but I don't know.
You believe that the worst person can go to heaven. Hitler, if he really has a change of heart and God touches his heart right before he dies, he can go to heaven.
My God is that powerful to save someone that depraved.
And
yes.
That is gross. That is disgusting.
Why is it disgusting?
On the justice.
Why is it disgusting?
It's not fair.
Oh, it's not fair.
Yeah.
So you believe in justice?
Sure.
Why?
That's why we have to fight for justice in this world and not say, like, oh, it's going to happen in the afterlife.
So you
that's lazy and immature and not being responsible.
You believe in justice because you have a just God and you're reflecting His goodness right now.
I want to live in a good community. That's justice is a part of a good community.
Because
when people get away and break the law, it's a breakdown. It's, again, it's going to lead to pain and suffering.
You have pain and suffering. You have happiness and joy. Once again, you're arbitrarily, you're choosing one over the other. You're assuming purpose and value and dignity in human beings when atheism cannot account for in a naturalistic universe. There's no value, there's no dignity, there's no justice. Who cares about justice?
Justice is what you create. You can have one society that cares about justice and they have just rules, the other one doesn't and they don't. And the society I think that is more just is going to be happier, more flourishing.
That's
all about consequences, like I said.
But that's the fallacy of a relevant thesis. That has nothing to do with answering the question.
Explain that.
Well, just because one society. How much time do you have?
Yeah.
You go. Okay. I've heard this example before, and I think you may have heard it too. That if a plane crash were happening, a survivor happened to stumble out of the plane crash, and a reporter came up to him and said, "How did you survive this plane crash?" And he goes, "Well, if I didn't, I wouldn't be here." He hasn't answered that question, and neither have you. When you're arbitrarily choosing one over the other, and you say, "Well, they wouldn't be here, or they wouldn't flourish in that," you're assuming something already when you say that. You're assuming purpose, that it would be better to live in a society that does harmonize and love one another and do all that stuff. That it's better that it's not chaos and killing and destruction.
Yeah. Well, I don't understand why that's not obvious.
Well, in the atheistic worldview, there's no reason to hold to that position, but I'm saying you hold to that position because your evidence, your suppressed knowledge of God to hold it.
No, I want to live in a loving, just, because you're kind of community that
you're created in the image of God, who is loving, who is just.
No, because I want to get along with people. I like feeling secure. I like having all those needs met. You know, there's the Maslow's hierarchy of needs. You know, you have to have safety and food at the very bottom, and the more you get on the basic level, you can get the higher actualization and more spiritual.
But you're trying to
self-fulfilling stuff.
So you're trying to say that though, that all these things like fulfillment, this is good. These are good things that we should pursue. Okay, but within the framework of your own worldview, what I'm saying is, as an atheist, a naturalist, a materialist, or I don't know if you necessarily hold to the materialist worldview, but there was a big bang, and now we're here, and we have synaptic firing in our brain, random chance universe, now all of a sudden we should care about the good of others.
Yeah, for a good community, yes. For a flourishing community, yeah. That's what morality is all about, is how to develop a flourishing community. It has nothing to do with God.
That's because God wants us to flourish. It says,
well, you know, I think when you bring God into it, it makes everything worse, because then you got people saying, like, this is what we should do. Why? Because God commanded it. Okay. And this is what we should do. Why? Because God commanded it. It totally
So who should decide ethics?
Like I said, largely, from my own study, number one is largely consequentialism. Another good principle is reciprocity, which is treating others as you want to be treated. Another one is individual rights, which means that people do what they want as long as they don't hurt others. And the reason why I came up with those is because they kind of answer different moral questions in different ways from different aspects. Because some moral questions go on one principle more than another. But the reason why I chose those is because they have the end goal of having a flourishing community.
But some people could be want to be treated in a way that would be harmful to others.
There are mentally sick people. They are.
Okay,
true.
So should they still be held accountable?
Sure.
Okay, let me ask you a question. When Hitler did what he did, you brought up Hitler earlier, when Hitler did what he did he know that it was wrong?
For him and Nazi morality, I would say he did what he thought was right.
So why did we punish him?
Because we have a different morality. I think my morality is superior to Nazi morality and also your Christian morality.
So if the larger consensus has a different morality, then they can impose that on a smaller census.
Yeah, that's the way morality works. The community, whatever they come up with the morality, that's what's moral.
So that makes it almost impossible for moral reform in society. What you're saying is the people, the abolitionists in the South, during slavery, they were the immoral ones because they went against what society held as a good thing.
I'm not sure you're getting that.
Okay. Society at that time said it was a good thing to own slaves.
Society fought over it. There was factions.
But it was a smaller consensus. It was the abolitionist society. They're the ones who were immoral because they tried to change the social morale of the day.
I think one of the things in the history of the United States is one of the things we come up with is we changed up. One change that's changed in the morality principle, it used to be like what the majority want. If the majority want this, then that's what we get because we are democratic or something. But there's another principle that came up with the individual rights, which says there's a minority over there, but they want this thing, and if it doesn't bother us, that's fine. So in other words, if they want to practice Jewish faith over that area, that's fine. These guys over here want the Bible in their school, that's fine. Maybe they can have a Quran in their school or whatever, that's fine.
So now you're saying that it isn't the majority of a society that chooses the moral ethic of the day. So now you're saying that you're not holding to that.
Well, the moral ethic that the majority of the society has is basically individual rights at this point. It's like, if that community wants to do that, and it's not hurting anybody else, so then it's okay. So it's basically like, for example, homosexuality. You can say, hey, I find it icky, but I'm not going to make a rule that nobody can do it. It's like, if these guys want to do it, they don't bother me. Then the new moral philosophy is like, well, they're not hurting anybody else. Give them the freedom to do what they want as long as they're not hurting anybody else.
I feel like we're beating the dead horse at this point. We have like 4 minutes left. Let me ask you this. How do you know that the future will be like the past?
I don't know it, but it's a reasonable conclusion. It most likely will be.
Okay. How do you know that to any degree that the future will be like the past?
We don't know it, but it's most likely because that's what we've observed so far without any change. I mean, it's been...
I think you guys about a minute.
Okay. It's been solid, repeatable. It's...
So, that doesn't seem to make a whole lot of sense to me. In a random chance universe, that you would hold to the principle of deduction that the future will be like the past.
We both agree to the logic of deduction, I think.
Yes.
So, I don't know what the point is of talking about...
Because it's something that...
You want to say that the origin of inductive logic is evidence for God?
No, okay. So Bertrand Russell, do you know Bertrand Russell? Mm-hmm. Okay. Famous atheist said that the principle of deduction is circular reasoning. So it's fallacious, it doesn't stand on its own. But you have to use the principle of deduction in order to appeal to science. Because you hold science as this ultimate authority. This is why you walked away from the Christian faith, was because of science. So principle of induction, you yourself cannot even prove that it even works. You just hold it arbitrarily as your a priori conviction that you hold arbitrarily. But there's no way to prove it on your foundation. But you use it because you do believe in God, and you believe that He does hold the universe together.
I'll give you the closing.
Okay, I mean, I don't really understand the argument. I mean, like, the thing about science and then maybe in the aspect you're talking about is a knowledge base. I mean, the ancients used to think there was a flat earth. They used to think the earth was on this firm foundation. Now we know that the earth is spinning at 1,000 miles per hour.
And now we believe in evolution.
Yeah, but the earth is spinning at 1,000 miles per hour. You say that's impossible. That's crazy. But it is around the equator. It's spinning 1,000 miles per hour. It's going like 68,000 miles around the sun, even though we don't feel it. These are scientific facts. And I think we both agree to it. So I don't...
Facts are opinions.
Like I said, everything is my opinion. Okay, and a fact just means it's something that you're using for a base to build upon. So when everybody in the academic society agrees to it as a baseline building block, they call it a fact. Stephen Jay Gould once defined fact as something so obvious it'd be perverse to ignore it. That's how he defined the fact.
We're going to move into our closing statements, and then we'll do question and answer. Bernie, since you opened, we'll let Ronnie close with his closing statement.
Okay. So basically, I don't think there's any evidence for the existence of God. I think all the claims, some of the easiest claims to show that the Bible God does not exist is if you think the universe is 6,000 years old, that's obviously wrong. If you don't believe in evolution, you're obviously wrong. These are obvious facts. If you still want to be a Christian, the only option you really have to do is to accept evolution. And for me, I don't think that makes sense because of other philosophical issues. And also, I think with modern neurology, we can show that the soul doesn't work, doesn't exist. It's just the mind that emerges from the brain. This whole idea of a soul, I'd say, is superfluous. I mean, it's something that can't use it. So I understand that humans, we have been bred from other creatures, and so one of the things that we're bred into us is a survival instinct. We are deathly afraid of our mortality. It's very natural to want to be in denial and say, oh, we can live forever. And that's what heaven and hell is all about, is the hope of the eternal life. So I just think part of being sober-minded and smart is understanding reality and grasping and coming to grips with it. And when somebody close to you dies, you don't have to say, I wonder why God took her, I wonder why God took him. That's nature. And it probably makes you appreciate life even more now. I mean, if you have a child that you lost or something, it should help you appreciate life and love those who are near and dear to you. There's not going to be another chance in the afterlife or some other time. We got to deal with what we have here. So I'll leave it with that. My appeal is to live in reality and modern knowledge. The Bible is written with an ancient and long scientific outlook, and I think it's very sad for people to, in our modern age, to go by this ancient scientific fact base. It's totally ridiculous to think that the universe is 6,000 years old, to think that we were created by magic, boom, there's humans, or boom, there's whales and fish and all that, and believe in a worldwide flood or any kind of a flood where all humans were killed except for atheists on Earth. It's pretty sad that people in our modern time, with all our modern knowledge, still believe this. So.
Okay. So, I asked you a couple questions during my cross-examination. I'd like to actually go over those a little bit right now. You said that we should, Bernie said that he thinks that we should advance as a society and create new technology. You didn't say that, but you said yes. Now, the reason I think he believes, or the reason why he holds to that conviction, is because God says, you've given him dominion over the works of your hands. He's talking about people there. God has given us dominion to reign over this world, create new technology, advance the society. He wants to see humans flourishing as beings created in his image. We want to see humans flourish. He said he likes to live in an eternal, perfect state, and that we don't want to die. We want to live eternally. This isn't just a random thing. This is us, again, having been created in the image of God. Revelation 22, 13, God says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. God lived eternally, and we have eternity written in our hearts because we were created in His image. This is why we don't want to die. We don't want to perish. We have an innate desire in us to live eternally. Also, He said we should care for the less fortunate. I don't think I have to go into why Christianity or the Bible teaches we should take care of the less fortunate. He says we should pursue truth. Philippians 4:8, finally, brothers, whatever is true. Think about these things. God wants us to search for truth because He is the foundation for all truth. It's the reason why we pursue truth. It's because God Himself is truth. This is the reason why we have built the logic and science and the principle of induction. God is logical. Also, when I ask, should we establish the quality or the reliability of something before we accept it as truth, and then hold to as many of these truths as possible? Well, 1 Thessalonians, again, 5:21, but examine everything carefully. Hold fast to that which is true. So, God wants us to believe in things that are true, things that are logical. God does not want us to murder, steal, stuff like that. Bernie is appealing to God every time he says facts. Everything is a scientific fact. But then he contradicts himself and he says everything is an opinion. An opinion is different than a fact. The reason why he's saying fact is because we can know some things to be true because God knows all things. And as beings created in his image, he has given us some revelatory knowledge. We don't wander around know nothing. How many people here are going to college or went to college? Well, you paid a lot of money to go to college. Did you really go there thinking that you weren't going to learn anything? That you were going to walk out of there with no knowledge at all? No, it's ridiculous. It's a ridiculous claim to make that you know nothing. Obviously, there are truths in this universe that God has given us that we can explore, and He can make us aware of some things to be true to some degree. I'll close with this. Paul says in the book of Ephesians, now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. That word ignorance is not meant to be an insult. But in the Greek, the word agnoia means a willful blindness of the truth. This is the condition those outside of the Christian faith find themselves, and the consequences of it are in the previous verse, when it says futile. That word futile means pointless. Everything that my opponent has used in order to make his case tonight is ultimately pointless. And any argument from the atheistic perspective is pointless as well. It gives no justification for why we should hold any of our convictions, and even worse, it cannot even begin to explain what exactly a conviction is, or how you can hold one that you can be certain about to any degree. Not even absolutely certain, but to no degree does it offer certainty. Alas, there is hope, though. For those outside the fold of God that engage in this kind of self-refuting thought pattern, Paul goes on to say this in the following verse. But that is not the way you learn Christ, assuming that you have heard about Him and were taught in Him as the truth is in Jesus. To put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and has corrupted deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds. Here we see that the truth is in Jesus. And He doesn't just save us for heaven someday, but He's also actively moving in those who have put their faith in His righteousness and not their own. Some of you may have missed that, so let me say that again. Christians do not gain eternal life by doing good things, but by trusting in the good things that Christ has done on our behalf. When Christians say faith, contrary to popular opinion, it's not a blind faith. That word faith in the Greek, pistuio, better translates to a trusting in. It's as if you were hanging from a cliff, and I said, grab onto my hand, have faith in me. At that moment, I'm not asking you to believe that I exist. I'm telling you to trust in me to save you, because at that moment, you cannot save yourself. As Christians, we're not better than anyone, but we are better off. So Christ saves you for heaven someday, yes, but He also saves your mind now, because it's been demonstrated this evening, hopefully, through the cross-examination and open dialogue, that we all have two options before us in this life that God has given us. Christ or futility.
Okay. Alright, this time we're going to move into question and answer. So if you have a question this time, please raise your hand and ask. First one I saw back there.
Thanks, Lord.
And please direct whether your question is for Bernie or for Ronnie.
Yeah, sure. Can both respond to those two?
Yeah, that's good. Briefly.
Adam. Ronnie, I agree with you that I believe God chose to reveal God's self in Christ. Bernie, I agree with you that if we don't have our cosmology right, we ought not be at the table. And I believe in evolutionary biology. Neil deGrasse Tyson's my favorite astrophysicist. So I'm going to be a little selfish in my question, bringing us back to the existence of God. How do you respond to the prime mover argument? I think is a good argument kind of in this universe of modern cosmology and faith. How do you respond to the prime mover argument for the existence of God?
Yeah, you know, like I said, what evidence is there for God, okay? And there is so much evidence we know about, for example, in the DNA. You know, how come Christian apologists don't say, look at the DNA, look at the evidence?
I'm saying, look at the prime mover.
I know. So what I'm saying is, we have all this evidence, and none of it points to God. So what do? They go out to the God of the gaps. How did the universe start? Nobody knows. Aha! Playground! Let me give you evidence. That's evidence for the existence of God. Everything you don't know, that's the playground. Let's go in there for evidence for the existence of God. They're not going to things we do know. Nobody knows what the universe came from. Nobody knows. Nobody even knows at the moment of the Big Bang whether even time started or not. Some people think time started. But nobody knows. Yeah, bottom line. You know, so it's just God in the gaps, and they try to dress it up with all these arguments. Well, we know this and this and this before that. Bottom line, nobody knows. Why don't they point to all the evidence, all the facts we do have? Because there's no evidence there. You can't point to DNA and say, look, God did it. You can't, because it says evolution.
Okay, thank you. Next question.
Well, I mean, Ronny might have a comment too.
We'll just keep it cruising.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, Ronny.
Yes. Bernie, so you made the claim that Christianity says that even Hitler could be saved if he had a sincere change of heart, but in the naturalistic worldview, isn't what Hitler did completely justifiable? If everything is completely relative to each person's opinion, in his own opinion, he was making the best decision and the decision that would bring him the most happiness, and not only him, but all of those who followed him. Wasn't his decision to eliminate the psychologically and physically disabled ultimately most beneficial to society? Why would that be wrong?
Okay, so basically, I'll restate what I said a little bit earlier. There's different kinds of morality, different bases for morality. So there's a Nazi morality. What he did is perfectly fine for Nazi morality, probably because he defined it, so he's not going to cross it. There's a Christian morality. I have my morality. I think my moral system is superior to the Christian system and the Nazi system. So you have to ask him, what is morality all about? What's the point? You know, if he's going to say it's the supremacy of the Aryan race, I would say, no, that's not what morality should be about. We have a fundamental disagreement about what morality should be about.
But
so
then
in his system, yeah, he did the right thing. According to my system, he did the wrong thing. According to the Christian system, he did the wrong thing.
But they're all opinions, right? If there's no moral absolute,
everybody has their own opinion. Everybody has their own opinion.
We're going to keep moving along.
There is nothing that says this is it.
Just one question. No follow-up question, guys, so that we keep moving. So
I'm a Christian who is exploring, don't really know where I stand on the issue of evolution and obviously being a Christian, I believe in creation, but God's venue for creation is something that I'm not completely convinced on, and that's not because any lack of faith on my part, and it's not because I all of a sudden became a science whiz, because I honestly feel completely unqualified to answer that question. But something, what brought this to my attention was when I was doing my Hebrew class in Bible college. The first two chapters of Genesis are written as a poem. They're written in Hebrew poem, whereas the rest of Genesis is written as like a historical account. We would never read a song and look at that and say, this is something to be taken literally. We would read that and say, this is something to be taken as a metaphor, as a poem, as an exclamation of something happening. So if creation is the movie, then some people would say evolution is the documentary on how the movie was made. My question for you, Bernie, is you said something that I was really looking for, what can help me with my issue with this. You said that there are philosophical consequences in believing in evolution and holding to a Christian worldview. I am curious what you think those consequences are and why you can't believe in both.
Okay, so I almost left the faith after accepting evolution, but I didn't. But then I went on to neurology. But I mean, here's the biggest problem though with evolution and Christian theology. I mean, if you want to present the gospel to people, normally there's Adam, there's a sin of Adam, and we all inherit this sin, and Jesus undid all that. The thing with evolution is there is no first humans, there's no first of any species, because evolution happens over a time and within a population. There's no such thing as a first human. So if you believe in theistic evolution, how does soul come into a creature? I mean, supposedly the soul was given at some point. I mean, if this group of people now mate with a the soulless people? I mean, is soul people mating with soulless people? Or, you know, same thing, if God just picked one guy and says, okay, you're Adam, now you're the first human. I mean, maybe Eve, too. Okay, well, their kids mated with other people, so you got people with souls mating with people with no souls. How do you know you're not one of the people that's no soul still? Maybe you never got in line with, from their descent. I mean, I've never heard anybody articulate anything that made sense. We're trying to figure out how the soul came into being. And everybody has a different, in Christian theology, everybody has a different idea of even what a soul is. Some people think all the animals have souls. Some people only think only humans have souls. What's the difference between a soul and a spirit? Every denomination will give you different answers on all this stuff.
Sorry. We'll keep moving along.
So a lot of what you guys talked about tonight is like way over my head on ology and deism and all this stuff. But one thing that stuck out was two times where we said that your morality is superior to the Christians. So I guess my question is, my limited understanding of evolution and survival of fitness and all that stuff, why do Christians still exist? Why are we here? What's stopping you from just wiping us all out? So it's like the superior human can continue to flourish and live in happiness as we can track the forms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one of the confusions there is the theory of evolution explains how species developed. You get one species from another species. The theory of evolution is not supposed to say this is how morality should exist. Now, the interesting thing there is you can study morality and see how it evolved. For example, there's a guy who wrote a book called The Primates and Philosophers, and he talked about how you can see rudimentary forms of morality in chimps and all kinds of other animals. So you can see how morality develops, and we have these bigger brains and more powerful brains, and so we have a more advanced state of morality. But it's interesting to see how other animals, they've actually taught monkeys how to gamble. And it's kind of funny to see what they do. They've learned some things about things. I mean, they actually had to teach them how to use a token and how to get some kind of value and stuff. I think they're capuchin monkeys or something. But
I could be wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. What was the question more along the lines of why not?
Why not just kill everybody if I believe in evolution?
Well, no.
If
an atheist worldview, if your morality is superior to the Christians, then why not just get rid of all the Christians? Is it just to boost your ego? Or?
Well, I believe morality is all about a flourishing community, and I don't think we should be killing people that we disagree with. So that's one reason why I don't think we should be violent at other people that we disagree with. I think we should do it through educational ways. Personally, I love a peaceful revolution, so I think the Bernie Sanders thing is a possible chance here of a peaceful revolution.
Yeah, cool. Next question. If anyone has some questions for Ronny, that'd be great too.
Caleb's over there.
He's going to stand up for a while.
Okay, yes.
Great. Hey, you guys. There's a quote by Stephen Novella, but it actually ends in a few questions, and I'd be curious to know your answer on it, Ronny. It goes, what do you think science is? There's nothing magical about science. It's simply a systematic way for carefully and thoroughly observing nature and using consistent logic to evaluate the results. Which parts of that exactly do you disagree with? Do you disagree with being thorough, using careful observation, being systematic, or using consistent logic?
So I don't disagree that we should use science. I think Christians should use science. I think that we're the only ones that have a reasonable justification for why we should use science and appeal to the uniformity of nature and the principle of induction, because we can actually account for these things. We have a God that holds the universe together. In a random chance universe, we don't have science. That's not something that exists in an atheistic worldview. Now, a couple times he said science disproves God, but that's impossible. If God is supernatural and science studies the natural, how is science ever to detect a soul or God himself? It's impossible. Science cannot delve into the realm of whether or not God exists. It's supernatural. Now, science can better help us understand the world we do live in that God has given us, and I believe God has given us very good tools in order to do science, but I don't think science can touch on whether or not we have a soul, as you said, through neurology. I think that's absolutely absurd, you know, considering that a soul would be supernatural, outside of the natural, so science should not be able to determine whether it's there or not. So, but I think science is a good thing. I think we should use it. I think a lot of good Christians do use science. Isaac Newton, there's plenty of them. I can go on forever.
Just a quick comment, too.
Yeah, I think the question was for Bernie as well.
No, well, I just want to make a quick comment on it. One thing Ronnie said, too, just to repeat what he said, too, is that
for example, I said there's evidence in the DNA for evolution, and he said, well, it depends on your preconceptions. He says, I could look at that evidence, and I have a different appreciation. So he's claiming that how you look at the evidence can interpret it differently, right?
Yes.
So I think that's the big answer that I'll should give. I disagree with that, but.
Great question.
Yes, sir.
My question's for Bernie. Your main gripe with the Christian God seems to be a lack of evidence. I was wondering how you felt about concepts like the multiverse or aliens, concepts that may seem it could be argued that there's not a lot of evidence for them. I was wondering if you accept or were open to ideas like that, and what made them different from the Christian God?
Well, the multiverse, like I said earlier, that I think this whole question is just beyond our ability as humans right now. It's an unknown, and so I would not say nobody knows, therefore this is some kind of evidence for the multiverse or something like that. I think multiverse is a theory put forth there trying to figure out what it is, but I don't use that for or against God. I said, let's look at the evidence. If you say your God did things that touched the world, such as created the world 6,000 years ago, that's falsified. If you said he created humans from scratch, that's falsified. If you said there was a worldwide flood that killed all humans except for 8,600 folks, that's falsified. There are certain things that are falsified, and I believe, I didn't get into it, but I believe we could also falsify the whole idea of the soul, and if we can do that, then it doesn't make any sense to believe in the resurrection, because that's all about the soul. So.
Yes, the question's for Ronnie. You talked about morality, you talked about using an example of slavery. I'm wondering how you reconcile the explicit verses in the Bible that condone slavery with our understanding that slavery is immoral.
One thing, I did not say that slavery was immoral. So that's something I did not say. Now, this,
right,
and I don't want to go on forever about this, but the slavery in the Bible was a lot different than the slavery.
God says it's not.
Right, the slavery in the Bible was a lot different, or the slavery during that time was a lot different than the slavery during the South. It was more of an indentured servant. So if I owe you debt, and I'm
going to pay you, can I pay for you?
No, not. This is different, and I want you to hear what I'm saying real quick. The indentured service system that the Israelites had was much different than what we had in the South. If I owed Rick money, I couldn't pay him, so instead of me going to jail or something, I could work for Rick as an indentured servant in order to pay off my debt, and there was rules and practices set in place that would set the Israelites apart.
Like being a slave,
but
to the point where they don't die, but if they did die, then you got punished, but if they didn't, if they got up after 3 days, then
here's my problem.
It's fine.
Here's my problem.
That doesn't seem right to me.
Well, here's my
problem. It seems immoral, actually.
You know what, absolutely, here's the problem though, and I said this in my opening statement, when you bring a moral indictment against a God, you presuppose an absolute morality. You're upset right now because you have a problem with beating people almost to death. Now,
I'm not presupposing an absolute morality, but I am presupposing a morality.
Well, you're just giving us our opinion. Why should we say that your morality is better than God's?
Because it works.
But pragmatism does not lead to truth, as I said with Turner. So, you bring the moral indictment against a God?
True.
You bring the moral indictment against a God is you know, silly, especially from the atheistic perspective. I mean, we all...
Let's steer this
perspective
away from a dialogue real quick, though. So,
right,
so,
sorry.
And leave it with a question and answer. So,
is slavery immoral?
Let me just answer real quick.
Is slavery immoral?
That's my question. See, you have to define what you mean by slavery, because that's...
Owning another person.
Owning another person?
Yeah.
No, I don't think that's moral.
Okay, thank you.
But the indentured servant is different than slavery. So
my question is for Bernie. Bernie, you say that atheists, like, they know that there is no God, but tonight you said that you could be wrong. So aren't you moving from more of an atheism to agnosticism, or could that be said?
No, I think it's a healthy mindset to always have the attitude you could be wrong about anything, because that means you're open to learn. If you have evidence, I would change any belief I have. Nothing is sacred and holy. I will change any belief if you can give me reason for it.
But could you prove 100% that there is no God?
No. Well, I would ask you the same question. Can you prove 100% there's no Santa Claus? I mean, you know, if Christmas magic is real, Santa could be real. So, I mean, to me, Santa Claus and God are exactly the same thing. They're both imaginary characters. There's no difference whatsoever. Darth Vader could be real, like Satan. I mean, to me they're the same. Darth Vader and Satan, the odds are about the same.
So, okay. Next question. Yes, sir.
I'm not sure about the agenda here. We're directed questions here. Do we give our own experience in supernatural to science?
Just questions.
Our own testimony, so, or do we listen to your answers?
Yes, yeah, so just straight questions, and you have about 30 seconds to formulate your questions. So not statements or...
We only can ask questions. We can't make our own statements.
Yes, sir.
Okay, my mouth.
Could you elaborate again on what you said about when Bernie was asking about God to you? Just that in itself proved that God was real. Can you elaborate on that?
He was saying that was circular reasoning. So, because, you know, I would say that, you know, I believe in God because he has revealed himself to me such in a way that I can know him to be true. And that seems circular. I'm using God to prove God, or I'm using the Bible to prove God, or using the Bible to prove the Bible. But the problem is that we all use circular reasoning. It's unavoidable.
No.
Absolutely. Because, listen, and let me explain this. When Bernie uses his reasoning, he has to validate it with his own reasoning. We all do it. I'll give you an example. If I came in here today and I told everybody, I'm the strongest man in the world. Now, I know some of you already thought that when I first walked in. But if you told me, prove that to me, but don't use your strength. Well, that's impossible. I need to use my strength in order to prove my strength. I need to use my intelligence in order to validate my intelligence. I need to use my reasoning in order to validate my reasoning. We use circular reasoning all the time. The difference is, the God of the Bible, or the Christianity, is not a fallacious circle. It's a virtuous circle. When you appeal to laws of logic, the law of non-contradiction, the law of excluded middle, the law of identity, in an atheistic perspective, you have no reason to appeal to that because you have valid human memory. You already admit he could be wrong about everything he knows, and it's all just his opinions right now. There's no truth.
Could you be wrong about everything you
know?
No. And why do you think that?
Because God has revealed some things to me such that I can know them to be true.
So I want to ask you about unicorns, okay? I really believe in unicorns. I do. I see them. I feel them. I feel their love. So I believe in unicorns.
Do unicorns give you a foundation for logic, truth, and morality?
Sure. Heck yeah. Unicorns are awesome. So I'm asking you about unicorns. Doesn't that prove that they're real?
No, it doesn't.
Okay, well then your reasoning is circular. May I also please add, all of us do not use circular reasoning, circular logic a lot. I don't use it. It's ridiculous.
How do you know,
use that?
How do you know your reasoning is valid?
I base my reasoning on science, which is provable with evidence.
But you have to use your reasoning in order to interpret that science.
Absolutely.
Okay, so you're using your reason to validate your reason as circular.
No, I disagree completely.
Okay.
I'm using my intellect to interpret the material and to make a determination about it. I don't use some, you know, like, because God told me so.
Well, that's the authority I appeal to.
Well, I'm sorry for you, because that's ridiculous. I like to think for myself.
Let's close out with
a quick comment on that. Let's look at a quick comment.
Okay.
My quick comment. Ronny says he knows something true because it was revealed to him. So what you have to think, though, and what you always need to ask yourself is, could I be deluded? How could I test if I'm deluded or not? Maybe this is a delusion. And I don't think I had circular logic because I used to be a Christian. I was open to evidence, and I became an atheist. But like I said, if you show me evidence, I will become a Christian again. So I'm not using circular logic at all.
In the interest of everyone, I think we can have this conversation afterwards.
Just to be proud of that. I haven't had it here for a while.
Oh, cool. Bernie, this is for you. Sorry, I kind of got hammered a lot of questions here. But I think you've been really respectful. Thank you for that. You know, given... you know, stark differences in worldview. But earlier in the debate, you asked Ronny the greatest evidence of God, and he said the Bible. And I would take that, and I would agree with Ronny, I would take it one step further and say it's not just the Bible, but it's the Bible then pointing to Jesus. And so I think what I want you to explain or answer is, you know, this book of the Bible, the books of the Bible written over centuries, different authors, different countries, all with so much consistency,
prophesying what's going to happen to Jesus. Jesus dies and resurrects, which is historically, historians and academics believe, yes, they do. Yeah, they believe that the tomb is empty. So he resurrected. So hold on one second, let me just finish. So how do you explain that? Because to me, in that moment, not only does, like, the burden of proof is now on you. I think the tomb is empty. Burden of proof is on you. And this lights up the whole, you know, centuries of the Bible and all these that would have been just kind of magical stories and ghosts and goblins, but all of a sudden something happened in real life that historians, academics believe, tomb is empty. How do you explain the resurrection? I mean, it comes down to Jesus.
Okay,
or whatever.
Two quick points. One point is the only historians who believe in the resurrection are Christians.
No.
That's ridiculous that for a historian to say, I believe in the resurrection, but I'm not a Christian.
That's
how can somebody say, I believe in the resurrection, but I'm not a Christian? That's crazy. Right?
It doesn't mean he's God. Just because he rose from the grave.
You think somebody's going to believe a guy rose from the grave, but...
Maybe they'll be a naturalistic
Christian.
Let me
seriously
answer the question.
You can't seriously believe somebody's going to believe he just rose from the dead, but yet he's not a Christian. The second thing is, the soon return of Christ is the most popular, famous, failed prophecy ever. It's famous. He's coming back soon. 2,000 years in counting. Even in, I think it was 2 Peter. You know, it's like, oh, people are saying, where's Jesus? He's supposed to come back by now. I mean, here it is, couple thousand years later. He's not coming back.
How
much longer do you have to wait? I mean, if it's a year 3,000, yeah, Jesus is coming soon. It might be tomorrow.
Yeah, well, I do know Christians who do have a problem with that. It's soon and now. Actually, one of our old pastors that like kind of led him away from his faith is that
the Bible is very clear. Jesus is going to return soon, and it just hasn't happened.
It actually did happen, but we should talk about that later. Actually, you and me offline.
We're going to go ahead and wrap up, guys. So, in closing, I just want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. And just real quick, if you guys do have any more questions or anything that you guys want to discuss. I know both these guys are probably going to be around for a little bit, so you guys are more than welcome to come up and discuss with them. And I'll let them close out for like a minute, so Bernie can explain his book, and so Ronnie can explain kind of just some steps and I think a class that he's offering coming up. So, and also, I think you guys would benefit greatly from coming up and talking to Bernie. He has his master's in theology, is that correct?
Master's in ministry, I call it.
Yeah, so. So again, thank you, Bernie, for coming out tonight, and thank all of you guys. So, Ronnie, do you want to close out with what you have coming up, and then Bernie, explain your book. You guys got. We'll do 30 seconds each. Go ahead.
Okay, real quick. We are from Gospel Community Church, but I think in the barn line you said.
Yep.
Over the next 4 Wednesdays at the same time.
6 to 7.
I'm going to go into further detail of this apologetic defense of the faith, this particular method. Obviously, I couldn't get anything in such a short time, but I am going to expand upon it over the next 4 weeks. And you can always reach out to me at Gospel Community Church. I mean, right now we're meeting at the UFC office. 3:30. Boom. All right.
Bernie.
Okay. In summary, I just want to implore you guys to learn more science and philosophy. I think the reason why so many people believe in God is because there's so much knowledge out there that we don't know. So, for example, you can know everything about biology, be convinced that evolution happened, and not know anything about cosmology. And so somebody says, "Hey, the Earth was created 6,000 years ago." Okay, I guess I believe in God. Or you can believe everything about cosmology and know about the Big Bang, but not know anything about biology, and say like, "Okay, well, humans were just made like that." So. You know, in neurology, Bible history, how the Bible was created. Like Mark Herman, he's somebody I really like a lot. He's a Bible scholar. He was a Christian, became an atheist or agnostic or just doesn't believe in Jesus anymore. There's a lot of debates, you know, like from him you can learn from. So you gotta really look at both sides. Don't be a Christian that listens only to your pastor. Please look at other sources. Look at both sides.
Cool. Thanks, guys. Have a good day.